more details of the upcoming UK carrier strike group deployment emerge. HMS Queen Elizabeth and the UK carrier strike group are due to set sail in late May. Here we outline the geographical and practical aspects of what is known about this landmark operational deployment. The deployment has many objectives. These include enhancing partnerships and conducting multilateral naval exercises and visits to many nations. Although only a transient presence in the Indo-Pacific, it will act as a reminder that the RN is back in the carrier game, and post-Brexit Britain is interested in renewed trade partnerships in what is now the most dynamic region of the world. It is a signal to China and other potential adversaries that, in coalition with allies, the UK is willing to uphold international law. For the MOD, it is a chance to prove the carrier, its escorts, aircraft and supporting logistic chain can deploy over long ranges and operate in diverse environments. It will also further deepen interoperability and integration with US allies. Getting ready. The carrier strike group will conduct pre-deployment work on Exercise Strike Warrior, as part of Joint Warrior 21-1, which will take place off the Scottish coast between 2nd and 13th May. It has been confirmed that USS The Sullivans will join the group for the entire voyage, being the only asset that has anti-ballistic missile defence capability. The Dutch government have also confirmed the participation of the air defence frigate HMS Evertsen. Both ships have previously been integrated into the CSG, participating in exercises during September 2020. Other pre-deployment preparations that have been publicized include Exercise Virtual Warrior, held in February, where CSG battle staff and warfare personnel conducted synthetic training at HMS Collingwood. HMS Queen Elizabeth sailed on a short workup and embarked munitions at Glenmallan in March, while RFA Fort Victoria is currently loading stores and munitions at Crombie Jetty in the Firth of Forth. Some details of the route that the CSG will take are public and detailed in the map below. This is only an indication of the outward leg of the voyage, a venture which represents the culmination of decades of work and an enormous amount of planning by various arms of government. Somewhat controversially, it seems to have been decided the CSG will not make the most provocative route through the Taiwan Strait. FINOPS in the South China Sea are one thing, but the decision to avoid adding to the tension between China and Taiwan has probably been made after long consideration and in consultation with allies, including Taiwan and the US. The Americans have sent warships through the straits on a regular basis but have not sent an aircraft carrier since USS Kitty Hawk made the transit in 2007. Subject to change. One of the great strengths of naval forces is their inherent flexibility, and plans may be changed at short notice in response to political requirements or other events. Other issues such as weather conditions, logistical or mechanical problems may also require the plan to be revised. Only a limited number of people will know the exact course for the deployment, and for security reasons the RN never gives precise details about the timing of port visits more than about 48 hours in advance. There may also be sensitive missions planned to be conducted within the voyage that will not be mentioned before or after. For example, the RN has provided virtually no detail of its operations in the South China Sea during the last few years. It should also be remembered there are many separate moving parts to the enterprise. The carrier group will not remain together for the whole time, and ships are likely to be detached to make port visits on their own. Aircraft may be flown off for visits to airbases, and if complex maintenance is needed, there is now a global network on nations that can support F-35, and Japan provides this option. The USS The Sullivans and HMS Evertsen may also temporarily detach to conduct missions in support of their nation's interests. Other vessels from partner nations are likely to join the group for periods for exercises, familiarization, and for the purpose of making a political statement. Many ports cannot accommodate HMS Queen Elizabeth alongside, and she may anchor a little way off in deeper water. She is well equipped for this scenario, carrying three dedicated passenger transport boats that are lowered from bays in the sponsons that overhang the side of the ship. Convenient passenger access can then be provided via pontoon lashed to the purpose-built platform and companionways at the stern of the ship. The ships will go into a COVID-secure state prior to sailing for Exercise Strike Warrior and then will remain so until they return home at the end of the deployment. This means visitor and media access will be limited and strict protocols have to be adhered to regarding who can leave or come on board the ship. This is a considerable frustration as it will limit the diplomatic impact that would normally be achieved by hosting guests on the carrier and reduce the media coverage. It will also restrict the opportunities for runs ashore, which would are a big part of the excitement for the sailors when going on a global deployment. Which way home? Although the deployment is slated to last around 6 months, it is unclear exactly by what route the group will return to the UK after operations off Japan. There are essentially three options. 1. Circumnavigation of the globe, e. crossing the Pacific, round Cape Horn and into the South Atlantic. This is probably unlikely. This requires a long time at sea and diplomatic benefits are limited. 2. Head south from Japan, possibly visiting Australia or even New Zealand, but then return home roughly the way they came via Suez and the Mediterranean. 3. Return on the westerly route but via Africa, rounding the Cape of Good Hope and visiting West African nations. Option 2 would seem to be the most likely. V-Systems tops 90% Aussie content for Hydro program. V-Systems has achieved 90% Australian industry content on its hydrographic in-service support program in Cairns. V-Systems spent $41.5 million across its suppliers in 2020, with 90% of that spent with Australian-owned and operated businesses. Since 2008, V-Systems has maintained the Liuwin and Paluma class vessels as part of the Hydrographic In-Service Support, HISS, contract, employing around 60 people and working closely with almost 200 regional and national suppliers. As the program enters its 13th year, V-Systems has committed more than $400 million to its trusted and enduring suppliers, many of which are based in the Cairns region. Maritime Sustainment Director Greg Laxton said, "We will ensure that enduring industry activities continue to be part of our role in the region, regularly engaging with industry to create more opportunities, enhancing capability and capacity for continuous naval sustainment. This program has enabled the growth and development of the supplier ecosystem within the region and supports the delivery of increasingly complex work scope, while reducing risk for the Commonwealth and Navy. We will continue our work with supply chain partners to support their bespoke development needs by facilitating engagement with the Centre for Defence Industry Capability, industry associations and regional development authorities. This kind of support is invaluable to our supply chain partners as it reduces the burden on them to understand and address what can be complex obligations and requirements."